It's time for The Verdict. The Verdict is a lively discussion of current events and legal issues pertinent to Oklahomans. The Verdict is hosted by Kent Myers and Mick Cornett. The Verdict is sponsored in part by the Able Law Firm. It's time for The Verdict.
And welcome once again to The Verdict. Hello, I'm Mick Cornett, and I'm joined as always by one of Oklahoma's top legal experts, Kent Myers. And Kent, today we continue our series on Oklahoma's impact players.
Yes, and today we have an impact player that represents Devon Corporation, Larry Nichols. Devon is located in Oklahoma City and is, by some measurements, the largest company in Oklahoma, anywhere from between $6 and $7 billion in revenue on an annual basis. And Larry Nichols is a very interesting fellow. He's done a lot of things, not surprisingly, what he has done. He's done well, and he brings a great deal of experience and expertise to Devon, but more importantly, he brings a lot of homegrown loyalty and a commitment to Oklahoma City and to Oklahoma. It should be an exciting show.
They have become a national player in that field.
Indeed, and some would say the national player.
We'll meet Larry Nichols, the president and CEO of Devon Energy Corporation. It's next on The Verdict.
Children deserve a life of hope and love, but sometimes they experience a life of pain, neglect, and abuse.
When that happens, each child deserves all the quality assistance and representation that can be offered in our legal system. Oklahoma Lawyers for Children has over 500 of the best attorneys and volunteers who donate their time and service to represent children in Oklahoma County. For more information, call 23-CHILD.
Oklahoma Lawyers for Children, helping to bring hope and love back to the lives of abused children.
The Able Law Firm, based in Oklahoma City and recognized nationally for its superior legal ability and very high ethical standards. If you've been injured or believe someone you love has been a victim and needs to talk to an attorney, call the Able Law Firm. Initial consultations are free. The Able Law Firm. In Oklahoma City, the number is 239-7046.
St. Gregory's University has been changing the lives of people like me for 125 years. Affordable, private Catholic education, balanced with dedication to community and service, makes St. Gregory special. We're extremely proud of our students' outstanding academic achievements and our nationally ranked athletic teams. It's when you help a student build a future of balance, integrity, and service that you change a life forever. St. Gregory's, a community for life.
The Journal Record is pleased to be a sponsor of The Verdict. The Journal Record, since 1903, the best source of Oklahoma business news and legal information.
And welcome back to The Verdict. Mick Cornett with Kent Myers, who's going to introduce our guest.
We are very pleased today to have Larry Nichols, who is the chairman, president, and chief executive officer of Devon Energy Corporation, as our guest on The Verdict. We have known Larry for a long time. He and I office in the Devon building together. Larry got his BA degree in geology from Princeton University and his law degree from the University of Michigan, where he was elected to the Order of the COIF, which basically means top 10% of the class. Since 1970, Larry has been with Devon. He was a co-founder of Devon. He's involved in many charitable and community activities. He has been elected to the Oklahoma Hall of Fame. He's married with two children. Larry, thanks for joining us on The Verdict.
Glad to be here.
We're really pleased to have you.
Glad to be here.
I mentioned you got a law degree. You had a brief but a stellar legal career because you associated with some people that all of our viewers will know. You started out your legal practice, I guess, or legal work as special assistant to William Rehnquist, now Chief Justice Rehnquist, although he was not on the court at the time. Tell us about that experience briefly.
Oh, that was a fascinating experience. Bill Rehnquist actually ran the Attorney General's office, and so we got involved in whatever the administration was hot and bothered about. So it was not doing the same thing every day. It was a different legal question, a different challenge every day.
And you were a brand new lawyer right out of law school.
I was a brand new lawyer, and it was a lot of fun because Rehnquist is a brilliant guy.
Well, then you continued your legal work at the Supreme Court as a law clerk to the Chief Justice.
Right. Worked for Earl Warren, another fascinating fellow. Every Saturday we'd go out and have lunch with the Chief Justice and his six law clerks, of which I was one, and he'd talk about politics in California, where he was the Attorney General and Governor for a long time. Fascinating figure in American history.
Well, and also worked for Justice Tom Clark, I think.
Yes.
Very fine gentleman.
And at some point, you got fed up with Washington and ready to come home and start Devon. Does that sum it up?
That sums it up, yes, pretty much. I had really planned on practicing law in Washington, but my father had the idea of starting a new company, and he persuaded me to come back. We had 3.5 employees when we started, and we actually were broke, but I wasn't that good at reading financial statements at that time and didn't know it, or I'd have never come back.
Well, what was the founding and growth history like? Can you go through those early years? How did it all happen?
Well, we started as a small little independent. My father had got to know some European investors who were interested in the oil and gas business and in the United States, and in mainly buying and producing properties that didn't have the risk of expiration. So we started out using those contacts and slowly built the business.
So you were buying properties that had already been discovered, developed,
essentially,
and were producing.
And by the mid-70s, we had a lot of undeveloped acreage, and we started exploring for natural gas and oil, too.
Well, today, your mission. Let's look at a graphic that shows us, I think, the mission of Devon Energy.
Okay. What we do is really two things. We want to both acquire producing oil and gas properties as well as explore for oil and gas properties, all that designed to enhance our production, to give us more natural gas and oil to sell.
We have a company-produced video we could show that kind of gives us some behind the scenes of your action. But your primary focus, natural gas versus oil, how does that percentage weigh out?
Yeah, if you look at it historically, natural gas back in the 50s and 60s was a waste product, and the product that you produced occasionally with oil because there was no need for it. Over time, it has become to be recognized as a very scarce commodity because it is the cleanest burning fuel in North America, in the world. And so for environmental reasons, it's become a very valuable commodity. Where we wanted Devon to be is that when the world really figured out that we did not have a surplus in North America, but we're going to have really tight supplies, we wanted to end up having a very dominant position in natural gas. And so both with the drill bit, with exploration, and with acquisitions, we've been trying to build up our natural gas portfolio throughout North America.
Well, let's go ahead and take a look at the video, and we also want to show a graphic after that that talks about your North American production. Talk us through here. What are we seeing?
This is a drilling rig, just a straightforward drilling rig, as you can see dotting the Oklahoma landscape and throughout the country where we drill. You know, we drill about 2,000 wells this year, which means we'll poke more holes in North America than just about anybody.
And in the Gulf, I think.
And in the Gulf of Mexico. Mm-hmm. We've built Devon up to where we're the now the largest independent holder of acreage in the deep waters of the Gulf of Mexico.
Stated in terms of not necessarily oil business talk, but layman's talk, how many barrels or equivalent barrels is in your inventory?
In gas, we produce about 2.4 billion cubic feet a day. And to put that in perspective, that's about 3.5 or 4% of the total gas produced in North America comes out of a Devon well.
Wow.
The big producers in North America are BP and then Exxon. And there are really three of us that are tied for third: Chevron, Devon, and a company in Canada. We actually produce more gas than Shell does, than ConocoPhillips does in North America.
Let's take a look at a graphic that shows some of your North American areas of concentration. go?
Yeah, this is where we're located. It stretches, we've already talked about the deep waters in the Gulf of Mexico. Goes right through Texas, where we're the operator of the largest gas field in Texas, up through Wyoming, where we're experimenting with gas out of coal bed, on up into Canada, where we're the second largest acreage holder in western Canada, and into the Mackenzie Delta, which is the Beaufort Sea up above the Arctic Circle, where we're the largest acreage holder there.
You mean land acreage?
Both land and offshore. In the winter, it's land because it's frozen. Then you can get out there. So it's a rugged part of the world to drill in.
Let me talk about your expanded scope, the international operations. So let's look at a graphic that we have of Devon's international operations. And walk us through that, if you will.
Sure. This shows where we're located internationally. The big focus is on in West Africa, also in Azerbaijan, which is a former republic of the Soviet Union, where we have an interest in one of the largest fields in the world that is not on stream at all. We also have activities in China, where we're about to bring an offshore field on stream in China, as well as smaller operations in Egypt and in Brazil.
Well, let me get us to a short break. We're visiting with Larry Nichols. He's the president and CEO of Devon Energy. We'll be right back. You're watching The Verdict.
All children deserve a life of hope and love, but sometimes they experience a life of pain, neglect, and abuse.
When that happens, each child deserves all the quality assistance and representation that can be offered in our legal system. For more information, call 23-CHILD.
Oklahoma Lawyers for Children, helping to bring hope and love back to the lives of abused children.
American Express Tax and Business Services. We're accountants. We do taxes, business valuations, estate planning, and consulting. And we're right here in Oklahoma, working with the owners of small and medium-sized businesses. Steve Wilsey and Stuart Meyer have the resources and the experience. American Express Tax and Business Services. In Oklahoma City, the phone number is 405-843-5311.
Bringing out the best in each student. That is the simple goal and tradition of Heritage Hall. Focus on the individual shapes the educational experience at Heritage Hall. Each student benefits from small classes, able, dedicated teachers, a solid academic curriculum, and exceptional co-curricular programs of athletics, arts, community service, and other activities, parental involvement, personalized counseling, and the development of responsibility, integrity, and love of learning. If you want education taught with pride, then you want Heritage Hall.
My mom's my hero.
My mom's my hero because she saved the baby bird that fell out of the nest.
She taught me how to swim.
She cooks on the grill sometimes.
My mom's my hero because she took the pledge to smoke outside.
Now no one can smoke anywhere in our house.
Until you can quit, take the pledge to make your home smoke-free. Protect your kids from asthma attacks, ear infections, and other respiratory illnesses. Call 1-866-SMOKE-FREE. Go out for your kids. You're their hero.
Mick Cornett, Kent Myers back on The Verdict. We're continuing our series of Oklahoma's impact players. This morning we're talking to the president of Devon Energy Corporation, Larry Nichols. You've remained in Oklahoma City throughout the years of growth. A lot of companies, we have seen them before, have moved to larger cities. I'm certainly sure that you've had an opportunity to do that as well, have chosen to stay in Oklahoma. How do you weigh that as a corporate partner for the city?
We've had, you know, a lot of times in our career, particularly when we went public, companies that said you really have to move to Houston in order to grow your business. And some of those companies that said we had to do that, we bought two or three years after that when they said, you know, we'll merge with you, but only if you move to Houston. Just never seen the need to do that. We can attract, particularly with all that's happened in downtown Oklahoma City with the MAPS programs and all of the incredible activity. We're regularly finding we can move people to Oklahoma City who would rather live in a smaller environment than Houston. and who like it here. We've had great success at that.
We have some videotape of the office building where Devon Energy is housed. You also seem to be committed from a corporate standpoint to be a good corporate citizen. Explain your involvement there beyond your business.
Yeah, I think any corporation plays a role in the society in which it's in. We've tried to focus a lot of our philanthropy in things that help Oklahoma City to build the core of downtown, because if the core doesn't work, then the rest of it doesn't. I've never seen a city that had a decimated core and the rest of the city prospered. So if we can keep the downtown working, which is going fantastic right now, the rest of it works.
Let's talk about employees just a minute. Approximately how many employees do you have in Oklahoma City?
We're about 850 in Oklahoma City.
And company-wide?
And company-wide, about 3,700. About 600 in Houston, 600 in Calgary, and the rest in various parts of the world. The largest number here in Oklahoma City with 850. We occupy about 475,000 square feet downtown. So we've come a long way. When we had 3.5 employees, the half is we shared a receptionist.
Where do you see Devon going in the next 5 years?
Our challenge, there have been a handful of companies that have sort of emerged from the large number of masses. When we went public in 1988, there were 400 publicly traded companies then. I do not know of any other industry that had 400 companies. That's
a lot.
Just
in your industry, there were 400.
Publicly traded companies just in the United States. There were another several hundred in Canada. A lot of reasons for that historically that went away in the mid-80s. So we thought there'd be a tremendous consolidation that would take place, and that if we were lucky, we could play a meaningful role of that. We thought there'd be a handful of companies that would emerge that were using modern technology and highly skilled people to build the company, and today we're one of them. It's easy to fall off that narrow group because the larger you get, the more competitive it gets, and that's our challenge.
Well, you're the largest independent in the United States, and you started in 70, which of course means that you survived the Penn Square bust, the oil bust, if you will, of the early to mid-80s, and you not only survived it, you've thrived after it. And yet many, many, many independents did not survive. How did Devon make it? What did you do? You couldn't have seen it coming, probably.
One of the things we do is we recognize the simple fact that oil and gas prices are cyclical. Yeah. They go up and they go down. And when prices are high, we get our balance sheet squeaky clean. When prices are low, because we went into that period with a clean balance sheet, we don't hesitate to leverage the company up and acquire properties that fit our portfolio, that fit what we're trying to do to build ourselves into a major gas player. And then as the commodity prices come on up, we use the cash flow to pay off the debt, which is exactly what we're doing right now.
What are you doing in your spare time?
if any.
This spring, my daughter got married, and that consumed a whole lot of spare time, and that was a lot of fun. My wife and I both, my wife puts my volunteer work to shame. She's very active in that area. And we enjoy hiking, we enjoy traveling, and we do a good bit of that when we can.
What about community charitable activities that you're particularly enamored with? I know you're involved in a lot of them. Name a couple of them that you are particularly happy about.
I've been fairly active in the Nature Conservancy over the last decade. Arts Council, just recently got on the board of the Cowboy Hall of Fame, which I'm excited about because that organization really has a lot to contribute to this city and to this country.
Well, I know your wife Polly's been very active in the National Memorial as well.
She has.
You have two grown children, I understand.
Right. The son got married 2 years ago, and daughter, as I said, just got married.
Are either of them in the business?
Nope. They're both living in Virginia right now, but I have hopes to bring them back here sometime or another.
Well, let me change the subject just a minute. Where do you see the industry, the oil and gas industry, the domestic oil and gas industry, going in the next 5 years?
There are some people that think that Exxon and BP and Shell will buy us all out, and pretty soon there'll only be three companies. I don't think that'll happen. If it does, it does. There's nothing we can do about it. I think there will be the independents that are solely focused on exploration and production, as opposed to the majors that have refineries and filling stations and all the different things they have. I think there's a real role for a narrowly focused but big and efficient independent, which is where we are now, and we're piling new ground every day. as we grow the business. You
know, presumably, there's a finite supply of natural gas and oil in the world. How is the supply long term?
Good question. Supply of oil in North America peaked in 1970 and has been in decline ever since, and there's nothing we can do about it. The rest of the oil, and there's a lot of it, is in places that are vulnerable politically, whether it's the Middle East, Venezuela, West Africa, Indonesia, places that are just not very stable from a political standpoint, which is why we have such volatile oil prices. They're caused by the politics of where the oil comes from. Natural gas is more focused in North America. We have a lot of natural gas supply. We've not really struck a very good balance between the country's legitimate environmental needs and the country's legitimate needs for reasonably priced natural gas, which is has caused gas supplies to be fairly tight here the last year and has resulted in electricity bills going up more than they really need to.
If we had a crystal ball here 100 years from now, will people still be using oil and natural gas?
That's a long time. I don't know the answer to that.
We won't be.
But I can answer it and no one would know. So, you know, who knows?
Larry, thanks for coming on our show.
We appreciate
Glad
it.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
Larry Nichols, the president and CEO of Devon Energy. Kent and I will be back with a final thought after this. You're watching The Verdict.
Freedom is not free, but it can be bought, not with money. It must be purchased in human lives. This wall of honor bears the names of all the Americans who gave their own life in the latest payment for freedom. We honor those who have died in fighting for our freedom. But this wall of honor is also built for the living and those still serving. We invite all of you to bring your photos of currently serving military personnel to be placed on the Wall of Honor. And I want to remind you that those who are serving in the current war in Iraq represent only a small portion of the troops who are stationed all across the world.
We're going to have lunch here today so Mrs. Blutberg can show us her paintings.
Ms. McDonald, what if my mom forgot to pack my lunch?
Well, would anyone like to share their lunch with Bill?
You can have this.
Sometimes the words of the Bible can seem hard to understand until you read them in the face of others.
Sorry, I got smashed.
This book is alive.
We are back. Mick Cornett with Kent Myers, and we're wrapping up another edition of The Verdict.
Larry Nichols in Devon is together make a very interesting story. Devon has just gotten bigger and bigger and bigger by leaps and bounds in the last decade, and yet has, as Larry pointed out, brought people to Oklahoma City, not taken them away. And their impact in Oklahoma City, downtown Oklahoma City, and the state as a whole is just tremendous. It's they're, as I said, by one standard of measurement, the largest company in the state of Oklahoma, and yet outside the business community in Oklahoma City, not many people know who they are or what they do. But what they do is explore, produce, refine, and sell natural gas and oil in a way that is very profitable to them and very useful to the community. And they take that money and spread it around in the Oklahoma environment, keeping a clean environment, and yet contributing to corporate philanthropy and other good works. And they're just an amazing story. They make a great impact.
Internationally.
International.
They're a player.
Let me ask you one other thing. Who is rated number one in many of the preseason football polls?
Well, Oklahoma for among schools.
Who is rated number one in another poll? The poll that tells us how many women per capita are incarcerated in any particular state.
Oklahoma.
Oklahoma. Puts in prison more women than any other state in the union per capita. And in the upcoming show, we're going to have Mary Fallon and Rob Wallace join us and tell us why that's so and what Oklahoma is doing, if anything, about it.
Should be an interesting discussion.
Should be.
Well, we want to drive people to two websites today. Of course, as always, we send people to our guest websites, devonenergy.com. devonenergy.com, and of course, theverdict.tv. For Kent Myers, I'm Mick Cornett. Thanks again to our guest, Larry Nichols. We'll see you next time on The Verdict.
The gift of imagination allows children to see a better world. Playtime allows them a chance to practice creating it. Don't underestimate the power of play.
Maybe you were faced with an unexpected pregnancy and made the choice to have an abortion. Now you're hurting, feeling alone. We're here to help you because we've been there too. Find hope and healing today. Call 888-80-WOMAN.
Discover the new program that has teenagers talking. Bomb Shelter.
I need to realize that if people are going to see me as different, I need to realize that I'm going to be treated that way.
By not playing sports doesn't mean I'm gay.
Why does it matter what color I am?
The times have changed.
I've had to ask myself, why am I doing this? Well, where's my faith? Well, why do I believe what I believe?
Bomb Shelter. Real teens facing real life issues head on. Every week on FamilyNet. On the next Gator Homecoming Hour.
Welcome to the Sydney Opera House in Sydney, Australia. The Gator Vocal Band.
I'm gonna sing just as long as it takes for a song to make sad, heavy spirits free.
Every dawn is a new sunrise. Every beauty he placed here for me.
Don't miss all this music and more on the next Gator Homecoming Hour.
John Tesh, and you're watching Family Net. Now, there's always something good on television.